Yeah, welcome everybody. People are joining. I can't actually see you. I've just got a tiny wee screen about well, all I can see is myself actually. And I know what I look like already, so it's not very exciting. But welcome particularly. I'm aware that there'll be people who might be here from New Zealand. It's going to be Sunday morning on New Zealand at I think you've just gone into winter time in New Zealand. Daylight savings has ended. So welcome to you if you're coming in from New Zealand. It'll be very late in India. I don't know if there's anybody from India here. So if you're here from India, fair play to you for staying out late. So I'm just going to rattle on a little bit like this until somebody gives me a thumbs up and lets me know that it's time to start. And just to let you know that there's also simultaneous translation into Spanish. So maybe Daikatu, could maybe you could be unmuted and you could tell people how to access that in Spanish. Would you be able to do that?
Yes, of course. Can I do
Wonderful.
that right now?
Yeah, if you could say that right now, that'd be excellent.
Excelente. Para los amigos, amigas que están aquí y que hablan español, en la barra de Zoom abajo, ahí pueden ver un icono que tiene como forma de globo terráqueo, que dice Interpretation o Interpretación. Ahí le presionan y cambian a español para escuchar la grabación, bueno, lo que está transmitiendo, traduciendo Sarvaprabha. Ahí pueden escuchar todo. Muchas gracias.
Okay, so I think we'll start. So, welcome to everybody. Welcome to Triratna Day. If you've just joined us, so my name is Nyanadhara, and I've been the host for the day. This is the sixth of six sessions. So it's been one could probably fairly say an epic day in London for myself and for Sangharakshita and for Akasajoti. We've been working together today. You'll meet them in a little while. And maybe I'll just give you a bit of a sense of what's happened today, how we've been celebrating Triratna Day. So we started in Monmouth Street. So Monmouth Street was where our movement started in 1967, so 57 years ago. And we recited the dedication ceremony, which of course has been a really, really important ritual in our community for that whole time. And after that, we heard from Mahamati and Nagabodhi, who were both at Ergian House at Istana, where Bhante spent his last years. And they were talking about some of the treasures in the current exhibition at Ergian House, the Foundations exhibition, which were about those early years of Sangharakshita's return to England from 65 until 70. So the second session, we were here at the London Buddhist Centre. I can't remember if I said, but I'm in the basement of the London Buddhist Centre in the breathing space room. And in the second session, we practiced the Metta Bhavana. It was an international Metta Bhavana, a special Metta Bhavana, and we had friends rejoicing in friends from all across the Triratna world. So that was in the second session. And in the third session, we did a little tour of businesses and communities in and around this place in Bethnal Green in and around the London Buddhist Centre. So we met people and we talked about what their lives look like and how their work and how their communal living is an aspect, even a crucial aspect of their Dharma lives. In the fourth session, we started in North London in a street where Dr. Ambedkar lived. Well, he didn't live in the street, he lived in a house on the street. And in the 1920s, and we started there, and then we heard a talk from Nagaketu, the first of a series of six talks from public preceptors. And then we had some breakout rooms and some questions and answers. So that was the fourth session. And the session that's just finished half an hour ago was a session where we heard from Windsource Publications, who this year are celebrating 50 years in publishing. So we heard from some of their key authors. We heard from Nagabodhi and Vidya Devi, who edited Sangharakshita and worked with Sangharakshita, publishing his works. And we also heard from the Windhorse team from Dunamaga and Malta and Liz. And so here we are, we find ourselves at the end of our celebration. And in the last session, well, not quite the end, there's still a wonderful, evocation of Dharmachakra. And I wanted to just start by talking about the Buddha. So, of course, there's the image of the Buddha behind me. And on the Buddha's right are the five bodhisattvas that appear on our refuge tree. And on the Buddha's left are the five arahants who appear on our refuge tree. And the Buddha is holding his hand in the Vataka Mudra, which is associated with Dhamma teaching. And of course, what we know of the Buddha's teaching has been passed down to us because somebody, or many people, remembered it down the years. And I often think, wouldn't it have been amazing if tape recorders were invented when the Buddha was alive and we could actually listen to the Buddha's actual words recorded on tape? I sometimes think that when I think about our own movement and how right from the beginning, even before our movement started, people were recording Bhante's talks, his Dharma talks, on tape. And it's just an amazing resource that we have. I've loved listening to those tapes, and they've been crucial to the development of our movement. And what we're going to hear about is we're going to hear about how that's developed over the years, how Dharmachakra has recorded and distributed those tapes around the world and what that's meant for the development of our movement, and how more recently they have developed the Buddhist Center Online. So I'm really delighted that we've got the celebration of Dharmachakra, particularly because Dharmachakra have put on this event. It's been a collaboration, but they've really been the brains behind events, not just Triratna Day, but lots and lots of other online events, retreats, and all kinds of things that they do. So I'm really delighted that we're celebrating them today. And yeah, I think that's all I need to say. So I just wanted to very warmly hand over to Chandrajasa and Virulila and Ananda, and I'm really looking forward to what you've got to tell us today, as well as Daiketu and Karinatara. So over to you. Look forward to hearing what you've got to tell us today.
Great. Well, first I'll ask for my colleagues to be spotlight with me, Chandradasa and Ananda. That's all right. We're going to have a conversation about Dharmachakra. So my name is Virulila, and I live in just north of Boston in Massachusetts in the U.S. And I was very fortunate to come to the Dharma and be introduced to Sangharakshita on cassette tapes as a mitra. That was the first thing I wanted to do, was volunteer to copy those cassette tapes and share them. And it was like a treasure every week to listen and then to make these copies and share them. And since that very first introduction, I've been in love with Dharmachakra. I find that it's a wonderful way to bring people together around the Dharma, and is really a representation of the whole of Triratna. And I had the great pleasure of meeting Ananda almost 15 years ago or so, and we chatted about things, and we're going to revisit some of those topics today as we talk through the history of Dharmachakra. As soon as Sangharakshita started giving lectures, he wanted them recorded, and Ananda happened to be there on the scene and happened to have recording equipment and was ready to go. So we're going to talk quite a bit about that. And that was the start of Dharmachakra. That was the origin, our origin story. And it was Ananda, I think, who helped to see the Dharma around the world by sending these recordings to different places where order members were establishing Buddhist groups, and people would come together, I imagine in a living room, but maybe a retreat center, and listen to Bhante's recordings. And sometimes Bhante was even there in the room listening as well. He didn't need to say it again. He just sat and listened again. And that's the way Mitra study worked for so many years. So these conditions are quite beautiful, I think, and quite auspicious. And it's a great pleasure to sit and have a conversation with the two of you about Dharmachakra. And I'm going to ask Chandradasa, if you'll introduce Ananda a little more fully, because you two know each other a bit more than I do.
Thanks for it, Leila. Actually, I'm going to introduce you a little bit first. Just,
oh, me.
It's so nice that you're here doing this conversation. One of the things that's most important to me about Dharmachakra is that it's a team. You're going to hear a bit from Krunatara and Daiketu later about team. But Bria Lila and I have been working together now for about 18 years, something like that, at Dharmachakra since I moved to the United States, which is quite something. It's like ages. It's ages and ages. And she's so dedicated to the work. She's so dedicated to the Dharma. And she's got such a deep love of Bhante's recordings and of the kind of, I think you are still in love with that thing of what you could achieve by sending the Dharma into the world and changing people's lives. It's amazing. And you're really good at exemplifying it. So thank you.
Thank you.
And I suppose that does lead into introducing Ananda, which is great. Oh, look, my computer thinks I'm speaking Spanish. I don't know why. Ananda, it's so lovely that you agreed to do this. When we had the idea, we were like, do you think he'll do it? Probably not. It's too late. And then you just said yes, because you're so generous. And the whole time I've been working at Dharmachakra, which is about 28 years now, you've just been sort of like everything from a friend to a bit of a patron saint to an exemplar to a mythic figure. All of which I love considering when I think about you. Probably for people who are watching this conversation or listening to this conversation, I think one of the most significant things about Ananda is he's the last remaining order member from the batch of original 12. So it's even deeper than just having founded Dharmachakra and the kind of body of work that has everyone, literally everyone in Triratna has studied. Everyone has heard those lectures or studied those lectures. Everyone who's ever trained as a mitra or an order member has taken part in a tradition that Ananda founded. But even more deeply, you're the last original order member standing.
Very fine. And, so.
It's great standing. You're in great standing. One of the stories I always like to tell about you, Ananda, maybe as a way into the conversation, is around, well, your kindness to me. I remember when I was very raw, young mitra, pitched up in Cambridge in this job that I didn't really want, if I'm being completely honest. I just wanted to train for ordination, and that was what was on offer, as it were. I remember coming to see you in Bristol, and you were just so welcoming, so kind, and you gave me a book of poetry by Ted Hughes, a first edition American copy of poetry by Ted Hughes. And I've always kind of held on to that memory as a sort of initiation, as it were, into the work. It's not about the work, it's about exemplification and about a life. And I'm really looking forward to us hearing more about your rich Dharma life and where its connection is with the roots of Dharmachakra. So I guess one of the first things is just, you know, hello, thank you. And here we are. You started in 1967, that was your first recording. Here we are, it's 2024. What's it like?
What's it like now?
Yeah.
What was it like then? Well, yes, I came to London. Actually, we've got the BBC to thank, really, because I came to London just to get a job with the BBC. And that's how it all started. And it just happened by chance that I walked past Monmouth Street from Regent's Park down to the Aldwych. And I just happened to go that way and saw this kind of shop, Japanese shop, really. And I didn't know anything about Buddhism. I didn't know anything about Sangharakshita had barely appeared on the scene, really. But I went into the shop I can't quite remember now why, but I think I bought a book on Zen by Philip Kaplow. I still have it, amazingly. And that sort of got me going. And I had kept going back to keep the connection going with Emil, who was actually probably the second or the third order member, as it turned out. But we had lots of chats about this strange teacher, English teacher, who was in India and who was going to come over to England shortly to set up, well, not to set up a movement, I don't think he'd realized that yet, but to do meditation classes. And I think that's absolutely all I knew. And so I had no idea about doing recordings of his talks, and obviously he hadn't really got that far yet. But I was just taken by the magic of this shop, the atmosphere of this shop. It was the sort of thing that I was always drawn to, sort of magical things and exotic things. And his window was full of exotic things like drums and incense holders and gongs and all that kind of thing. And I just got talking to him. He always made tea for me whenever I went in. I think that was a skillful means. And I just got to hear about Bhante through him, really, through Emil. And as it happened, I was just in at the right time, to just before Bhante was about to come and give some talks and do a few meditation sessions, perhaps, in London. So I was kind of there on the spot. And these two things of being at the BBC and having a certain technical know-how with tape recording, and being there to meet Bhante when he came, those two things just came together rather serendipitously. So it really owes a lot to that, really, that chance meeting with Sakura in Monmouth Street.
How was it that you came to actually make the recordings? Did you volunteer?
Bhante asked me to do them. And I always, well, I suppose, I don't know why. I mean, he didn't like to refuse, really, because he was such an imposing character. And I happened to have, you know, the ability to do it. I just bought a Revox tape recorder, which was the sort of semi-professional recording machine of the time. They use them in the BBC, but I don't quite know why I chose that. I must have heard something about them. And so that, you know, the means to record Bhante's talks was there, and it all came together just like that, really.
So I really see you as becoming the bearer. And I have this, we're going to show some pictures lately, but in a little bit, but you know, bearing these huge pieces of equipment and yes, kind of
very heavy.
Heavy. Yeah. Yeah.
On the tube as well.
Yeah. And then you had told me before that you then started shipping copies of talks out. And I'm curious if you know, looking back today, looking back to then, did you have any idea of the significance of that act of service?
Absolutely not. No, mm-hmm. none whatsoever. My whole idea was to kind of record Bhante and get as much on tape as I could of his talks. And then the idea came later, months later, maybe a year later, I'm not sure, that to record these to send out to groups. Because it wasn't really, there wasn't much else outside London, to be honest, right at the beginning. There was the Buddhist Society. I don't think there was even Croydon at that time. The ones I remember going with Bhante to set up a new Buddhist group were places like Brighton and Nottingham, who were quite early ones, I think. That's all I actually remember of what we did.
Yeah. Well, somehow they made it all the way to New Hampshire here in America.
Yeah, well, it did, yes. Gradually, as Bhante did more talks, yeah. I recorded them and got into the habit of sort of, as a new group was established, and we'd send up the tapes. You know? Mm-hmm. Maybe sometimes the tapes went in ahead of the group, so there was someone who was interested in Bhante's talks and wanted to hear them, so I sent the set of tapes, and then he'd sort of be inspired to form a group from that. So it could happen that way as well.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Mm. Actually, Ananda, I wondered, just tying it into your ordination, I'm guessing it's not a coincidence that Sangharakshita gave you the name Ananda. given the role probably that Ananda has in the scriptures. How did you feel about that? Did it feel like a big archetypal weight, or were you aware of the significance?
I didn't really think about it all that much, because I felt it was rather ironic, because obviously the name means bliss or happiness, and I really wasn't a very happy person. I certainly wasn't feeling blissful at that time, if ever. But, Bhante sort of knew a bit more than I did, I think. I think he suspected that I'd hang around a bit longer and do something else. So I think, there were the two aspects to it was that the Buddha's close disciple historically, who went to all his talks and took it all down in some form, not on tape, I suppose, in those days. And then the sort of bliss, the meditation aspect. I think it was a kind of Bhante saying, well, if you start meditating, you'll end up being blissful and happy and all that. So a bit of skillful means. It's taken me a long time.
Well, you're certainly wonderful to be in the presence of, so yeah. So I'm thinking maybe it's a good time to do one of our polls that we have, if Aparajita is ready. We've got some clips. Audience
participation.
Yeah, some audience participation. So we have a 1960s clip that we're going to listen to, and then we're going to ask you to guess which talk it's from, and there'll be a little poll.
Yeah. We'll do a few of them. We'll talk about the lineage. That
what was not there before comes into existence. When circumstances are favorable, the succeeding stage of development is able to transcend the preceding one. And this is possible. This perpetual self-transcendence is possible because life, because the evolutionary process is itself eternally transcended by the absolute reality upon which it perpetually and everlastingly draws.
And then can you throw up the poll, Aparajita, for 1960s? There we go. So you can go ahead and guess which talk that little clip was from.
You see some pictures as well, where we're doing these ones.
Yep. Well, the poll's going to be in the way there for me anyway. There we go. There's Ananda and Sangharakshita.
Can you still see the poll?
Yeah. Yep. Is that the only picture we're going to show, or is there one more? That's the only picture. All right. We've got... So I can share the results of the poll. Is that all right? We're good. Another 5 seconds, maybe. Got one more guess. Okay, I'll go ahead and share the results. This is a smart group here who recognized the those who selected evolution lower and higher are correct. Did those results show up for you? Can you see them? Oh, there we go. Yeah. Okay. Are we going to do these slides now, Chandradasa?
I think Aparajita's having some technical problems with his mouse.
Okay.
Aparajita, if you switch quickly back to Zoom and then back to the slideshow, it usually sorts itself out. Otherwise, just take the slideshow out of full screen, and that should help.
Oh.
Yeah, we're just gonna do the 1970s and 1980s one as well once Aparajita's got control of his mouse again.
Yeah. There we go.
Stopping your sharing just now, Aparajita, in case you weren't able to do that.
Yeah. So we'll just let Aparajita refind his mouse, pray to the Zoom gods, and you can let us know WhatsApp what's going on. And we can come back to our conversation. And at some point, Ananda, a team began to form around your work, right? And some others joined you in that. And eventually, Chandradasa, you became part of that team. Just wondering if you've got any recollection of what that was like, early days team forming.
Who did you hand on to back in the day?
I thought it was Ashwajit, but I'm not absolutely certain of that.
I think it was Ashwajit. I think you told me that ages ago. Was Sagarmati involved at some point?
No, and not to my knowledge. No.
Not to your knowledge. Nagabodhi?
No, Nagabodhi, I handed over the newsletter to Nagabodhi. But not he was doing the newsletter. Yeah.
And the newsletter became Winterhouse Publications eventually, I suppose, somewhere.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
And did that, it's interesting that lineage, that sense of you just find yourself doing something and then you do it and then you hand it on, and because it's around something as important as Sangharakshita's core Dharma teachings, it starts to take on a life of its own.
Yes. I wasn't really aware of being in a team. I didn't really feel a team around me at all. It was just a question of going to the groups and getting to know the groups a bit and how they responded and what kind of things that they were interested in. And then, of course, in about 69 and 70, people started getting ordained. So then they became more of a team product.
And so so just looking back, so and we're going to do another audio clip from the 70s and then one from the 80s. And this is sort of the height of when all these teams were forming. We had restaurants and centers being built, and in here, recording Bhante's lectures becomes part of an integral part of all of that, I imagine. So I'll ask Aparajita if we could do the 1970s clip, and we'll listen here to Bhante again.
But if we have been familiar with the spirit, as we may say, of the Dharma Vinaya, if we've had even a little taste of it, we will see the Dharma Vinaya as more and more and more wonderful. It's important, therefore, to keep alive this feeling, this sense that the Dharma Vinaya is a wonderful thing. According to Plato, philosophy begins with a sense of wonder. Certainly, there's no spiritual life without an ever-continuing sense of wonder, a sense of wonder with regard to the Dharma Vinaya.
Thanks, and then we'll throw up that poll, and you can guess which talk that's from. These are three talks given in the 1970s. Yeah. And we'll just leave the poll up for half a minute or so if you want to cast your vote. We've got Enlightenment as Experience and Non-Experience, 1975, The Transcendental Critique of Religion, 1979, from the Vimalakirti Nirdesha, and The Taste of Freedom, 1979. And then we have a photo here of Ananda with all that equipment. And I think you told me the other day, Ananda, this is actually was recording some creative arts.
Yes, I don't think it was a talk with all that rubbish strewn around the floor. But what we did, and I suspect it was that, we did a sort of experimental music session in which we sort of took a piano to pieces and played it in pieces and put microphones all over it. I think it may have been something to do with that.
Wonderful. I love it. Wonderful. All right. I'm going to share these results here from our poll. And the talk was, or the clip was from The Taste of Freedom. So I'll just close that down and we can take a look at something. This is Ananda. Do you want to tell us what we're looking at here?
I think what we're looking at here is the first set of accounts, such as they are, from doing the tape copying in 1970. So that's pretty early. It's pretty rudimentary.
It's beautiful.
I think one thing that the BBC gave me apart from sound experience, was in recording everything in the sense of taking account, making account of everything. So I took meticulous notes about the cost of everything and where what happened to it and where they went to, and even items in Bhante's in the lectures. I sort of methodically sort of listed everything that he talked about and what how many minutes in from the beginning it happened and all that kind of thing. So scrupulous recording of details.
And who is this?
We should have audience participation. You can type in if you recognize who this person is. I'll give you a clue. He's the upcoming chair of the College of Public Preceptors.
Oh, Mahamati.
When he was in a German prog rock band.
Nice. Great. And should we do that last poll from the 80s now?
Yeah. Oops. Apparently the polls are disappearing behind the screen share, so maybe we could just do the poll this time. And then a few people are sending questions as well, which we can...
Okay, good. So, Aparajita, let's do the last or the third audio from 1980s.
Buddha, hero, homage to you, O best of all creatures, who released me and many other people from pain. All pain is known. Craving as the cause is dried up. The Noble Eightfold Way has been developed. Cessation has been attained by me. Formerly, I was mother, son, father, brother, and grandmother. Not having proper knowledge, I journeyed on without expiation. That Blessed One has indeed been seen by me. This is the last body. Journeying on from rebirth to rebirth has been completely eliminated. There is now no renewed existence.
Let's have your guesses. You're muted, Berlina.
There's the poll. So we have a case of dysentery, 1982. A wreath of blue lotuses, 1983. And Between the Twin Zala Trees, also 1983. This was a series entitled Incidents from the Pali Canon.
Given in New Zealand, I think. I don't know if Nyanadara can confirm that, but I think they were given in New Zealand.
And this later became, we're going to be transitioning into the digital legacy shortly, but this topic of stories from the Pali Canon became a CD, I believe, right? That was sold.
That's right. Kind of, yeah, later.
Yeah, yeah. As our transition into the 90s is going to come up soon. So while we'll give another second or two on that poll, and then see, maybe one more question for Ananda here from his time. Yeah.
Sangharakshita asked, you want to do the result first?
Yeah. So let me just share the results here on the poll. So can you all see that? There's several of us doing tech things behind the scenes, I think. So actually, it's a very close tie there between Aretha Blue Lotuses and Between the Twin Zala Trees. And it is indeed from an excerpt from A Wreath of Blue Lotuses. So do check out those talks. We're going to have a few more polls later on as well. I'm going to stop sharing that and over to you, Chandradasa.
Yeah, I was just going to, well, actually two things. One, Ashwajit Sudhira, who's in France, wondered if Virananda was one of the people who did Dharmachakra in the early days. Do you remember?
I think he did, yes. Yes. I'm not quite sure of the sequence, but he did do some of that, yeah.
Well done. Well done, Sudhira. And Sangharakshita was asking, do you have a favorite talk or do you have a particular memory, a favorite memory of making a particular recording that stayed with you?
I can't say there's one that I particularly... I think the one I felt most kind of stimulated by was the whole series of The High Revolution of Man, because I've always been very keen on evolution of every kind. And it brought it to the West a bit more in Western terms rather than... that I felt I had a bit of connection with, yeah.
And that would have been one that you recorded on the reels, is that right?
Yes.
So those were listened to in real time when you were recording them, correct?
Oh, yes, they were. They were live lectures. Yeah.
Mm.
I never did any cassettes. The cassettes were after me.
I mean, we could speed up the recordings of the cassettes, but on the reels, you can't speed them up when you're copying them.
Slog all the way through it.
And listen to it and take it in over and over again, right?
Yeah. Well, that was one of the advantages, of course. I not only recorded them, but I went to all the retreats and listened to them as well. So it did eventually, a lot of it went in.
It's quite beautiful. Yeah. So anything else, any other questions that came in that I can actually see?
No, not from the chat. We could
so feel free to put questions in the chat if you have them, and we'll try to come to them at some point in the conversation. And this seems like a good transition point to look at how we went from the reels to cassettes and then into the digital legacy and into the digital world. And there was a short stepping stone of CDs in there.
Very
short. Yep. And this is where I kind of came on the scene, I think, because I purchased the last set of cassette tape series, which was Mind and Mental Events by Subbuti. And that was part of a fundraiser to fund the digitization of all the talks that Bhante had given. And so that was in the mid to late 90s. Is that right? And then can you say share with us a little bit, Chandradasa, about what was happening then?
Yeah. Well, I joined Dharmachakra in 1996. And at that point, it was tapes. You could, Ananda, you could record them at 16 times speed. So we had a 16 times speed copier, and it had three banks on it. So you could record more than one copy. It was very exciting technology. And it was also already miles behind the rest of the world, who were all listening to CDs and all of that stuff. And I guess I had the same sort of training as you, where I got to go and record. In fact, I think I recorded all of Bhante's late period talks from sort of the mid-90s through to when he stopped giving talks. And also working with them, you just got to know them a lot, because you heard them so often. Mm. Although we copied them at speed, when we looked at the digital stuff, I'd been listening in my kind of spare time to music on computers for the first time, with MP3 files. They were very kind of new, and there was a service called Napster, where you could just go into anybody else's computer and take their audio files. It was completely legal. They didn't come up with laws about this until afterwards. And you could just open your computer up and go and find people's audio. And I remember thinking it would be really great if you could do that with the Dharma. It would be a much more efficient way of distributing. It was really lovely. People used to tear a page out of the back of this paper catalogue we had, and they would send it to us with their orders on it, and we would fast copy the tapes and print the boxes and send them out to everybody. But
you
it's
mean
not
you
very...
don't do that anymore?
We don't do that anymore, but we might. Maybe we should start them back. Apparently, kids these days love listening to cassette tapes. I don't know why, because they're terrible. Yeah. But maybe we should do that as a fundraiser. Anyway, we here we go. Here's the cassette tapes, and you might remember these if you're of a certain vintage.
I remember that one. Yes,
that's right. That was the cover. Ratna Prabha at that point was running Dharmachakra and then became the chair. And he passed it on to Shantigarbha, who hired me. And let's see the insert. Yeah, you used to get these lovely diagrams that are very esoteric inside the tapes.
Mm.
I still don't know what this diagram means quite, but it's really it's really beautiful in a certain way. So yeah, we had these tapes, and the digital world had already started to happen with compact discs. And there was a certain I think resistance to technology. So for the millennium, we decided to do a project called the Digital Legacy, where we would convert all of Sangharakshita's talks to digital format for initially compact disc. And the genius idea was to resell all the talks to Buddhist centers around the world because they already had them all on tape. And we were like, no, 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 buy them on CD. And that would fund something else. So we managed to do that. We managed to sell the CDs, this lovely design by Damarati. And we recorded Sangharakshita reading some of his favorite readings from the Pali Canon, which was to mark the millennium, really. But it became clear that as soon as we started selling the CDs, the world was moving fast. The internet was beginning to take off, and that's where it belonged. So I started talking to people at Dharmachakra before I got ordained, and then afterwards in 2001, about what would it be like if we just stopped selling them and gave them away to people and just trusted. It was very early days of the internet. Everybody was feeling very optimistic about the internet. It was going to solve everybody's problems, and information wanted to be free. So we had this notion of mutual dana, where if you just gave people what they need, they would also support you back. And that's been kind of the model we've operated on since with everything we do at Dharmachakra, is just giving the Dharma and asking for the support you need in return. So yeah, in a way, the digital thing sort of blossomed into the internet. And I remember turning up at a big Triratna meeting. I was invited to a meeting of chairs, and I think Parami was there. She's on this call somewhere. And showing the assembled chairs an iPod and trying to explain what an iPod was and how you could fit all of the CDs, which used to come in a gigantic box full of like 270 individual compact discs with jewel cases and printed material and all that stuff. You could fit all of them on this iPod and still have room for like your favorite songs. But I think it's fair to say for a while people really didn't get it. And fair enough, in a way the internet wasn't such a big thing in people's lives as it is now. But gradually over time we stopped selling things, and we just asked for support for a few years while we built an early website, which was a version of Free Buddhist Audio. And in 2006, right at the end of 2006, we turned on Free Buddhist Audio. I remember pressing the button to turn on Free Buddhist Audio. And I lived next to a river, and it was at nighttime, and it was dark in winter. And I was like, oh, somewhere I think emotionally I thought fireworks would go off or something outside, but nothing happened at all. It was just like, oh, nobody noticed. But the years of preparing the material were amazing for me, because I got a really, I think, strong grounding in Bhante's approach to the Dharma. I think I had to listen to all the talks twice all the way through and then split them all up into tracks and summarize what was in each track. So that took a few years of work, and then render the files digitally and you know, upload them to a server and learn about things like web servers, which I knew nothing about whatsoever.
And the team at that point in time, it was just you and one or two other people, correct?
It was just me, and then we had a part-time Akasha Priya, who was a friend of mine. We'd got ordained together. Akasha Priya super generously worked for 2 years kind of part-time to build the original Free Buddhist Audio with me, and he didn't take any money at all, which was just as well because we didn't have any money. So we were just like, you know, incredible generosity from Akasha Priya. And then over time, we, you know, people started to donate a bit, and we got a little bit of central funding money, and we were able to take on a part-time web person to keep that work going. But it was really just a team of sort of one and a half for quite a long time.
Mm-hmm. So we're gonna kind of look at the evolution of the Dharmachakra team here in the next part of this segment. But before we do that, I just wanted to really celebrate your vision that you could see kind of into the future a bit in terms of how the internet would become a way to thread us together as a community. And in addition to really holding Bhante's lectures in this way and making, you know, those cassette tapes that I had all disintegrated, and I don't have a way to play them anyways. So you've kind of preserved the audio files of Bhante's work, but you also opened up our voice collectively through Free Buddhist Audio by inviting centers to have their own ability to upload their talks. So that allows future generations and future Dharma teachers to share their thoughts as well. And so that ability to see that and build it, I think, is quite remarkable. So I just want to celebrate that. And I don't know if you want to comment at all about it, but I just really appreciate being able to listen to talks since Parami's here. She's one of the people I listen to quite a bit to help inspire me when I'm going to give a talk.
Well, yeah. I think one of the things Bhante did and Ananda helped kind of bring into being was that he founded another oral tradition, but the oral tradition is very strong in Buddhism. If you all of the scriptures that we have are all orally transmitted. And in a way, I think it was a bit of genius by Bhante just to adopt that model and give talks and get other order members to give talks very early. There's lots of quite early talks by other order members that were available quite early too. And it was particularly great on the internet, being able to, as you say, just invite centres to upload many more talks by women. We got a grant from the UK government, believe it or not, to increase the number of talks by women in the mid-2000s. And now there are something like 5,700 talks on Free Buddhist Audio. It's astonishing. And there's loads in the archive that are still there on tape, unreal, that have never been transferred. So that's a whole other thing. We will be doing some work on that next year. It's to try and redigitize all of what's left of Bhante's audio and the rest of the archive.
Remarkable. So this is a good segue into our last two polls. And so, Aparajita, I'll just tag you there for poll number 4. This is from the 1990s now. And while he's getting that set up, we're, again, just welcoming questions if you have them. Please put them in the chat.
So this was the sort of situation, it seems, that the Buddha wanted to prevent. And this is why he set forth the 8 important rules. He wanted to make quite sure that Mahaprajapati wanted to go forth for purely spiritual reasons. He wanted to make quite sure that she really wanted to go for refuge, really wanted to gain enlightenment. We can take the matter even farther than this. We've seen that Mahaprajapati tried to present the Buddha with a fait accompli. We've seen that she tried to force his hand, that she stood outside the porch weeping and wailing, that she tried to get her own way in a rather childish fashion. So we can see that Mahaprajapati, or in Mahaprajapati, there was a strong element of what Blake calls the female will.
So another couple of seconds on the poll there. And this one in particular really struck me, this excerpt, because it's a talk I had never seen before or heard before. That might give you a clue as to which one it is, but another second or two. Okay, let's go ahead and end the poll and share the results. It is, we had wisdom beyond words, standing on holy ground, and a life for the Dharma. All of these from the 1990s. And that excerpt is from a talk called Standing on Holy Ground, which I had never listened to before, never come across it. So one of the things I do is I curate the Free Buddhist Audio podcast, which is pulling out excerpts from talks for the Dharma Bites and selecting full talks that we send out around the world. I think we've been doing it for 16 years now or so. So I'm pretty familiar with the body of work there, but hadn't heard that talk. So let's do the last poll. This is going to be from the 2000s now.
This suggests the transcendental nature of Buddhahood, apart from all things, apart from everything worldly, everything mundane, even the subtlest mundane experience or sphere. But Buddhahood is both immanent and transcendent. It is beyond all duality. This verse also says that at the end of my quest, I shall find the Buddha sitting beside the pool of peace. This pool of peace is samadhi, is the purified mind, the purified citta. It's there, if anywhere, that we will find the Buddha.
Great. Thanks, Aparajita. So the three talks to choose from here are Fields of Creativity, 2002, Footsteps of Delight, 2001, and Dreams and Rebirth, 2008, which is, I think, one of the later talks Bhante gave that's quite good, quite worth listening to. They all are. This excerpt is from, I'll give you another second, and then we'll close the poll, sharing the results. Footsteps of Delight is where that excerpt is from. Yeah, so thank you everybody for participating in that. And we're going to transition, I think, at this point to the other project of Dharmachakra, which is the Buddha Center online. Yeah. So after Free Buddhist Audio was established, Chandradasa, you began envisioning other ways for our community to come together. So just within a few years, I think, of Free Buddhist Audio sort of gaining ground, you began seeing how it could be, we could be even more connected with each other around the world. And just invite you to say a little bit about how the Buddha Center Online came into being.
Yeah. I mean, to be honest, a bit like Ananda's story of just, you know, Bhante asked him to record the talk, so he did it. We launched Free Buddhist Audio sort of the end of 2006, start of 2007. And it, you know, because people had been so skeptical about it, it didn't really particularly take off. At least we weren't aware of it. People don't queue around the block to listen to Buddhist Audio. And then we got lots of good feedback and we redid it a bit. We reorganized it behind the scenes a bit. And then that seemed to really start to work for people. And within a couple of years, I think people were using that website very widely in Triratna, or in the FWBO, as was, because we hadn't changed the name yet. And we didn't really have a proper website. We had a blog. FWBO.org was a blog. And there was a big meeting where people were trying to prioritize and strategize about the future. And one of the things that happened was that the movement began to wake up to the internet and what was coming, the sort of scale of the change that was coming, which is kind of like the Industrial Revolution. It's that size of societal transition. And I think it was really just that I was in the room, and because we'd built a website and people all knew it and they used it, they were kind of casting around for anyone who kind of knew what they might do with a website. So they sort of asked me to do it, or at least they asked me to review communications, and particularly online communications. So I wrote a big review of it and then spent a few months in the UK having meetings. And Bhante was great. He was always right at the cutting edge. He was such an early backer of Free Buddhist Audio. He was such an early backer of what became the Buddhist Center Online. And he actually did a seminar with us at Majumaloka on communication as a way to frame this report that I'd written. And that was really, really great. And I thought kind of naively that was the end of it. I was just going to give him this report and then I was just going to go back to my nice little world with Free Buddhist Audio and keep transferring tapes. And there was nobody else available. So they basically asked me to come up with what became the Buddhist Center Online years later. So that whole process was between 2008 and 2010. And in 2010, we got a little bit of funding for the first time to try and develop a project. And of course, these kinds of projects are very expensive and they take a long time when you've got such a small team. So we developed it over the next 3 years. And the first version of the Buddhist Center Online was launched in 2013. So it was a bit haphazard and accidental, but, you know, things emerged.
And one component of this is the live events, like what we're doing today. Yeah. So this is making this possible, right? And I think you started out like around 2010 with like some urban retreats, and then you were on the scene. The Dharmachakra was on the on site for live streaming, sharing. Bhante's funeral, so that we could be there. Those of us who couldn't be there could be there. And
yeah, that was the phase where people's internet connections still weren't super fast, but they began to be fast enough for many people at home with a computer to stream something. It was quite different from these days, but we did a live before the Buddhist Center Online started. We did a kind of live international urban retreat online, and there were some live talks and events during that, quite short. And you definitely, mobile phones didn't really exist in the same way, so you couldn't do it on your phone. And over the next few years, we started to experiment. So when the site launched, we did some live ordinations for the first time, live public ordinations. And then eventually people had iPhones and Android phones, and they could tune into those, and cell connections, mobile connections got faster. And yeah, by the time Bhante died in 2018, most people had the ability to connect somewhere. And yeah, that was, Bhante's funeral was filmed two ways. One, there were some really fancy cameras set up, which you can go and watch the lovely edited film of that event. But what people watched live was me and Manisha on our phones, filming.
What?
Because the technology even then was a bit ropey when it came to broadcasting from the middle of Herefordshire. So it was kind of a bit of a miracle that it worked, but it did work.
Wow. And then I have this beautiful memory of sitting in a living room, I think it was your living room, while we were learning about the pandemic descending upon us. And
that's right. Yeah.
We were just about to open up the Portsmouth Buddha Center in New Hampshire in a couple weeks' time, and we had to decide to close. And you kind of leapt up from the couch with this idea that, oh, this, we can use the Buddha Center online to stay connected when we were going to have to be in our homes for a lot longer than most of us ever imagined. And from that emerged our twice daily meditations, the bodhicitta practice, all these beautiful forums and the home retreats. And how did this all happen? I mean, this is not a three-person team anymore.
I think part of it was, like, the BBC was interesting. I knew Ananda had been involved with the BBC, and I was really interested in the BBC as a model for how you have a media platform that's kind of got some state involvement, as it were, but it's also making good programming that people want and they buy it, etc. And I think the fact that we had a platform, an imperfect platform for sure, but a platform, meant that when something like the pandemic came along and it became apparent that within a few weeks the whole world might shut down for who knows how long, in the end it was quite a long time, we already knew how to run events. We already had ways, we had email lists and you could follow blogs, and we had ways basically for people to be connected. So it wasn't too much of a sort of a jump to think, okay, well, how could we, what do you do at a normal Buddhist center? You go and you meet with other people and you practice. That's what they're for, right? That's what they're for. So in a way, it was extending the metaphor of the Buddhist center into a space where people go and practice. And in a way, the Dharma Toolkit thing, we had a platform where we could spin up a separate website for live events. And we did that within, I think it only took about 3 weeks or something. And as soon as lockdown started, we were kind of ready to go with live events. And in a way, the community brought all of that. So it's the same as the community uploading all of those talks. The community turned up and people asked for daily meditation and a chance to go deeper with home retreats. And then the order bodhicitta practice started, which was amazing. And all sorts of really creative, fantastic things have happened. And I think when you have a platform as a community, it's going to reflect the life and the riches and the strength of that community. And I think at its best, that's what the Buddha Center Online can do. And we're looking at the kind of new version of it now that's live for everybody. And it's amazing. If you just spend time looking through the platform, there's so much goes on in Triratna all the time. It's amazing. It's this constant flow of practice. We call it the great stream of practice. And live events has been a particularly key part of that because it's survived the pandemic and is now an even bigger aspect of it. It's one of the main things we do is we bring people together. I think last year, I mean, just for ticketed events, we do quite a lot of non-ticketed events where we don't track attendance in quite the same way. But for ticketed events, well over 2,000 people bought and donated for tickets to come on live events and sort of international audience. I think somewhere you'll see some demographics. So here we go on screen. Quite a wide spread as well of age groups in terms of where the sort of penetration you can get with Triratna Dharma, with Bhante's approach to the Dharma, etc. So yeah, that's been a really key part of it. And also, to be honest, it generates income and it generates dana with which we can then extend the platform and build what we need for the next phase of Triana's history. including a
Wonderful.
team, which we'll come on to, I guess.
Yeah, so we're going to, I think we're at this point, I don't know if we're going to show more of the team.
Yeah, we've got some pictures of the
Let's
team.
look at
So
the
this is
pictures
the
of the
current
team. Okay.
Dharmachakra team. Is there's 11 of us. We did have 12. We had to make some cuts recently, and we've gone down to 11. But it's still amazing that you can sustain a team of 11 people. And it's a fantastic combination of Future Dharma Fund, who've really helped kind of us go to the next level in terms of both team and what we can do as a team, by providing a much higher level of central, as it were, funding. And that funding comes from Future Dharma Fund, donors, and from the European Chairs Assembly, who've been kind of long-term supporters. The order itself also invests in the project, and Dharmachakra itself has gradually built up quite a big portfolio of donors who support the whole thing. And on that, we can, this is the thing I find makes me most happy actually about it, is, well, two things. One is right livelihoods and giving people the opportunities to work. The opportunity for younger people to have that as a viable career path, you know, something they could do rather than just take any old job and practice in the background, as it were. So we've got a number of younger people working at Dharmachakra, and that's amazing. And I think in a way we tend to talk in the team about the team is the product. It's like we've got these amazing things like the Buddhist Center Online and Live, the Buddhist Center Live and Free Buddhist Audio, but the team is the product. That's it's all that kind of flow of work and love and connection and inspiration that makes it all happen.
Yeah, beautiful. Beautiful. So at this point, thank you so much, Chandradasa, for sharing all of this.
No,
And
we've lost Ananda.
we've lost Ananda because it's quite late for Ananda. So if we could bid Ananda a bit farewell and see if he pops back. Really appreciate him being here. And we're going to hand over to Diaketu, who joined the Dharma Chakra team about, is it about a year and a half
And
ago, I
Karuna
think?
Tara. Yep.
And then, and also Karunatara, right? So Chandradas, I don't know if you want to say anything about transitioning here, but we'll.
Yeah, just a little bit actually. When we were talking about this session and how to talk about our work with Future Dharma and also just what it's like to be on a team, one of the things I really love is that we have two international online teams in Triratna. In fact, more than two. Windhorse Publications is kind of an international online team now as well, but I think Future Dharma's team and Dharmachakra's team have been sort of blazing a kind of trail of like, how do you do it differently? If you're not all going to be in the same space in a, I don't know, an old, probably slightly damp building in a corner of London that you can afford, then how do you do it differently? And this is how we do it. So I think team is the, well, team is the future of it. It's the past of it, all the way from Ireland in 1967, all through these decades till now. And well, Karunatara and Diaketu are newer members of these amazing teams. So we thought it'd be great to just let them say why they're doing what they do.
Yeah, thanks.
What we were going to do first of all, actually, before we speak, and yeah, Diaketu is there in Chintamani in Mexico, and I'm here in Manchester, and we're going to have a little chat about what's so special about working in online teams. But before that, I was actually going to just do a little bit of a summary for Future Dharma Fund. So yeah, we just wanted to say that we're nearing the end of the day, and we've been reflecting on the genesis of our movement. From one man's vision in a humble London basement, we're reminded of that transformation that lies within each of us, and that Sangharakshita was tireless in promoting this transformational journey. As we've just been hearing, how Dharmachakra recorded these treasures and shared those words around the world. And today we're building on that legacy and looking ahead. We've been hearing how it spread amazingly. I really love what Virya Lila's saying, how Dharmachakra has spread around the globe, how many people it's reaching, those trailblazers carrying on that vision and spreading the Dharma. These ripples of transformation are emanating right the way across our community. They're vast and ever expanding. And it's through the generosity of our donors at Future Dharma Fund that we can amplify this. And we've got new groups in places from Tokyo to Scarborough, Pueblo to Madrid, right around the globe. But many people come across Triratna, as we've been hearing from Chandradasa, through the Buddhist Center online. That's where they first hear about our movement. And that global content is provided for a global audience, delivered by a virtual global team. We saw those lovely pictures of that team that are everywhere around the globe working together. And that's made possible by these modern team-based right livelihoods that Diakato and I are going to talk about in a minute. So we all really benefit from the content and this very modern content now of the Buddhist Center Online and Free Buddhist Audio. But also I'm really aware that it's taken to another level for a lot of people living in remote locations or challenging living situations. The Buddhist Center Online is their Sangha. That is how they come together. And there's people here tonight, I'm sure that is true for them. They don't have a center to go to necessarily. And the Buddhist Center Online gives them that Sangha. So we've received a lot of blessings today, including from champions like Ananda, who set up Dharmachakra and who continue to bring that to us and bring us together. So we want to ask you if you would to reflect all of our generosity for the day and enable more people to meet the Dharma wherever you are. Wanted to ask you if you might consider giving a gift today, and we were hoping we might raise £5,000 in total for more Dharma projects to reach more people around the world. And if we've been saying across the day, if 100 people were able to give a gift of £50, which is 58 euros or 64 US dollars, then we would reach that target. So I'm asking you to consider that. You might think that's rather a lot of money today. And I do want to thank a lot of people who've already gifted that, which is brilliant. Thank you very much. So there's going to be a link go in the bottom for you to make a gift. And I'd just like you to consider what you would like to give, what you feel moved to give today to help us continue sharing the Dharma and reaching out around the globe. Yeah, so thank you for considering that, and hopefully that link's coming soon. So yeah, Diakato and I want to just talk for, I think we've got 5 or 10 minutes to just talk about what's so special for us. I too have fairly new at Future Dharma Fund. I've been there for 15 months or something. And there's 9 or 10 of us that work at Future Dharma Fund, and we come together 6 or 7 times a year, which feels quite special. But we're not quite as international as Dharmachakra, but we have people in Dublin, we have people in Barcelona and right across the UK. So yeah, I have really, really loved getting to understand their sanghas, what they do, and us between us creating a very modern hybrid digital team-based right livelihood. That's very new experience for me, having worked out in the commercial world previously. So what do you think special for you, Diakato? What has been so special for you joining from Mexico a team-based right livelihood?
Well, first of all, I'm very happy to be here. Thanks everyone also for being here with us. I mean, it's been completely life-changing, to be honest, working for the Dharma. For example, whenever I was training for ordination, my private preceptor told me that encouraged me to go to the UK and get a sense of internationality around the Sangha. Yeah. And then, of course, whenever I joined Dharmachakra, he immediately said, like, oh, wow, you won the lottery. And I actually feel like that, because in a way, I think this is a perfect combination on how to get support for us, kind of a sufficient living or having the money that you need, the support that you need, but also at the same time working, at least speaking for me, something that deeply, that it's very inspiring for me, that being able to help spread the Dharma, So the internet or these virtual environments, of course, it's very important that in person, contexts, but also online, it's also very important. And it's for me, it's just having the right context to kind of make a difference. Before, now that you mentioned the previous experiences, before I was working 10 years at Sony, the company that manufactures televisions, computers, PlayStations. So at that time, I had like an insight that was rather painful at the time, that I was I realized that I invested 10 years of my time and of my life, and actually didn't do anything for this world to be a better place. So at that time, of course, different stuff happened. But then whenever this opportunity came to work at Dharmachakra and, well, this this wonderful team, I really felt connected with a kind of sense of value, I don't know, inspiration, like a lot of stuff. For example, something that we do regularly on a weekly basis is having a dedication ceremony. So we go online like this on Zoom, and then we recite the dedication ceremony once a week, every Monday. So that's really important for me, because that kind of puts into perspective that it's, of course, not a regular work. It's not like 9-to-5 work, but it's something that is connected with my inspiration and also aspiration. It's a spiritual practice, but also is done with also some colleagues, some team members, some friends. And that's beautiful. I don't know, how do you experience that kind of thing?
Yeah, that really resonates with me, that building friendships, connections, and a shared vision that we are between us, enabling people to reach the Dharma wherever they are, however they are. And for me, as a fundraiser, there's also a real joy in getting to know our supporters, our ambassadors all around the globe as well, who so really generously support and want that for everybody too, so that it feels like a very collective experience. It's not just about the 10 of us in the team, it's our 600-800 donors as well, who generously give, and people today who've generously given. And that's how this movement has grown, hasn't it? And grown and grown. And it feels really live for me that we're doing something in a virtual way, a new way to be a team-based right livelihood and share and grow friendships and grow the movement.
Yeah. And also something that I have identified that is very important for me is that also in interactions, is that it's very different from my previous work in interactions. In a way, because I know that there is friendship, and also there is like the same common ground of ethics, of practice, of values, of inspiration. So that kind of resonates whenever we do something. I know that like I have experienced this a lot of times, that it comes out of friendship instead of authority or something like that. It just comes from friendship, and that's rather different. Whenever I was at Sony, I usually said that it was a world of asuras, and that I was an asura. And at that time, I was a very good asura, in a sense that I was very competitive and things like that. But in here, it's completely different. I mean, it's not about being competitive. It's really, truly being friends and working together, and for the benefit of all things, like we say it on many, so it's kind of acting on that, not just saying it. So that's really something for me.
Yes, it's very lovely to be congruent with what your deepest desires and deepest beliefs are, along with a collective of people, is meaningful. Yeah, and to be able to really practice, create, you know, I was thinking we're studying the Sangha of Vastus together. And so those four qualities and sharing those and really deeply, you know, in communication and in sharing vulnerability and really being human together as well. It's a fantastic way to practice too.
Sometimes this happens. Maybe Chandradasa will not like this, but sometimes whenever we have some meetings, for example, I have a weekly meeting with one friend that is called Sak and also Sagadara. And we have this weekly meeting like lasts for 1 hour, and then it's like 50 minutes and we're just talking, checking in and reflecting and going deeper on our friendship. And it's like, oh, well, we only have 10 more minutes to talk about business. Let's catch up on things in terms of work. But also kind of having those kind of connections is very important. For example, whenever we have a practice week, of course, coming online, and then it was very important for me because we explored a confession and ethics and everything. And I really felt that that brought me together to everyone whenever we did confessions and we shared our reflections and everything. So, yes, I really appreciate this context on team, of internationality. It's wonderful.
Yes, we're getting an opportunity. We come together as a team occasionally at Astana, so for 3 or 4 days. I'm really looking forward to that. That's the highlight of the year, to work together, play together, study together. Is really magical and special, and we're very lucky to be able to do that at Astana, and they host us really beautifully, so that feels very core to what we're doing, right in the heart of our movement in the UK. Is there anything else you'd like to say, Diaketu, before we hand over? I'm not quite sure how much longer we've got, really.
Not me neither. No, but I think that it's important also, at least coming. I mean, I'm from Mexico. For people that maybe don't know, that's why sometimes English comes as a challenge to me. But the thing is that also being able to be given this opportunity of working on a team-based livelihood, there are not many opportunities here in Mexico to work on a team-based livelihood. The only opportunity is if you work at the Buddhist center, but there are no other contexts like retreat centers or cafes or anything like that. So that's why whenever Bida City says like you won the lottery, I really feel like that. Not only because of the wonderful team and also the context and the opportunity to being able to dedicate my skills and my time to the Dharma, to help the Dharma reach more people. But also because it's an opportunity for my practice. I'm continuing to explore on how this activity is something that can help on a spiritual life. And it's an ongoing process. So I'm really happy to be here. And by the way, I'm here at Chintamani Retreat Center. So that's why it's very hot in here, 35 degrees centigrade or 95 Fahrenheit. So it's really lovely being able to be here, being part of this.
Yeah, that's the wonders, isn't it, of Zoom and us being together and sharing each other's environment. I think that's one of the things I find so exciting about Buddhist Center Online and those events, and also the teams, just to work alongside my colleagues. You know, I'm learning about what's going on in the Barcelona Center, what's happening across Europe. It's just really inspiring. As you say, it's very inspiring to keep our practice alive and keep working together for keep each other inspired and learn from each other in that real deep way, even though, you know, that's often through Zoom, through WhatsApp, through chat. You know, it's just really great, and those connections deepen and deepen. Really, really enjoyable.
Well, I don't know how much time we have left. If someone can give us a clue.
Well, thank you so much. It was a wonderful thing to hear the story of Dharmachakra right from the very, very early days, the first days even, right into the present day. So it's just been a real pleasure. I've just been sitting here with Akasa Jyoti and Sangadhara, listening to the whole thing. It's been a particular pleasure because We haven't, because we've been moving around London, we haven't been able to hear all of the content of the day fully. But it's been a real pleasure just to see friends from Dharmachakra talking about their work. So thank you to Virulila. Thank you to Ananda. Thank you to Chandrajatha. Thank you to Diaketu. And thank you to Karunatara. So thanks very much. And actually, at this point in the day, what I want to do now, we're just going to have a very short ritual in a moment. But before that, I just really want to thank people. So the contributors to the different sessions have already been thanked. And I am very, very appreciative of people of giving their time and putting a lot of work into thinking about what they can say that's going to help us to celebrate Triratna and help us to really bring alive the sense of transformation that is our movement. Our movement is a sort of vehicle for a spiritual transformation. That's what it's about. That's what it's for. And I'm really grateful for people giving some thought to that and how they can present that in this kind of format internationally across the world. The people I wanted to thank at this point are the people who have been working behind the scenes, who you might not have noticed. So first of all, I wanted to thank the tech hosts. So it's quite a thing to knit all this together in Zoom. There's a lot of pedaling that goes on. There's a lot of swimming, the legs moving very, very fast under the water. So I particularly wanted to thank Apparagita. So Apparagita is based in the north of England. He's been amazing, doing a lot behind the scenes, sharing things, working with all kinds of things behind the scenes. So thank you to Apparagita. Thank you to Zach, who's been at Adistana today. So he also filmed the first session, as well as tech hosting on, I think, three sessions. And Chandrajatha as well, who has been tech hosting, operating the Zoom for, I think, 2.5 sessions or something like that. So big thank you to Apparagita and Zach and Chandrajatha. Zach's been at Adistana. Chandrajatha's based in New Hampshire in the United States. The other people I want to thank, and I think in a way these are the people who've really worked hard, is people doing simultaneous translation. So as we've been talking, they've been translating what we've been saying into Spanish. I actually don't know how people can even do that, but people have been doing that. And most of the people who are doing that, they don't do that. It's a hard skill. Simultaneous translation is something that is a hard skill, something that you study to do it. And a lot of the people are doing it. They're doing it sort of, as it were, out of love. And I'm sure they've been doing an absolutely fantastic job. So making what we're doing available to people who speak Spanish as a first language, or people who speak Hindi, either as a first or a second language. So I wanted to thank in particular, so Claudio Herrera, who's in Cuernavaca in Mexico, not a million miles from Diaketu, actually, as it happens. Also, Salva Prava, who's also in Cuernavaca. Powell, who's from Mexico but lives in Texas in the United States. And Paramachita, who's living in Valencia. So they've been translating into Spanish. And I also wanted to thank Amoga City, who translated Naga Ketu's talk, and he translated that session into Hindi. So a big thank you to the translators, the interpreters. And the other people I want to thank, and the people who were involved in setting this event up. So I wanted to thank in particular the team at Future Dharma Fund. So Alex, who has done a lot of the media, social media for this event. I want to thank Kusala Raja, who was involved, very heavily involved in setting up the event, and also Varabandhu. So thank you to Alex, Kusala Raja, and Varabandhu at the Future Dharma Fund team, as well as all the people who did the appeals over the course of the day. So that was also Surinaga, Sugaba, Pundarika, and Nandavajra, and Banayuta. And the other people I want to thank are the team at Dharmachakra, who have been working It's amazing how much work goes into producing something like this. Like, it's really quite complex to weave all this together. Basically, what we've been doing is kind of like live television, but kind of like doing it in a kind of a little bit in an improvised shoestring kind of way. So there's a lot of work that needs to happen to make that happen. So I particularly want to thank Chandradasa, Daiketu, so you've just met both of them, and Sangadara as well, who's with me in the room. You'll meet him in a moment. And I also wanted to thank Bodhi Kamala, who is also based in Mexico. She's in Toluca. She's our international communications officer. She's been involved from the outset of this project as well. The other person I want to thank is also in the room with me, and that's Akasa Jyoti. So she was in particular involved in setting up session four, which was the session, the first of the talks from public preceptors. So we had a talk from Naga Ketu. And I wanted to thank what I've been calling the filming team. So that's basically Akasa Joshi and Sangadara. So maybe you've been behind the camera all day, most of the day. Maybe you could come around in front of the camera just so you can see the team. So Sangadara has been holding a thing called a gimbal, which is a sort of a handle that you put your iPhone on, and it's kind of an amazing thing that you can use to film. So he's been literally every bit where I've been in front of the camera, he's been behind the camera, and that's been quite challenging actually, particularly the bit we were wandering around the area. And so he's been a trooper. We've actually been going. We set off from the London Buddhist Centre at 6:45 this morning, and it's now 11 o'clock. So it's been quite a long day and quite a full day. And we've had all sorts of adventures. We've been all in, well, not all quarters of London, but a few quarters of London. And the other person I wanted to thank is Kasa Jyoti. So she's been absolutely brilliant, because it's been quite complex, let's just put it that way. All these different arrangements of connecting to this thing here and then moving over here and getting on this tube. And then we walked, it was hilarious. We walked down to Bethnal Green tube station. So that was going to be our quick way of getting around London. And there's a strike today. And the central line, which is the line that connects Bethnal Green with the rest of London, is closed. So we had to pull out the stops and get a few Ubers and all sorts of things. So Akasa Jyoti has been absolutely brilliant. And kind of in a way, all the things that hadn't been properly organized, she sort of tied together at the last minute so we could make this happen. So I am indebted to you, both of you, for the work that you've done today to make this happen. I'm really, really, really grateful.
Yeah, Nadara, before you go any further, I'm going to rejoice in you because you have been amazing, amazing to work with. This is like our third time we've done this, right? We've done like two Triratna days at least and a Sangha day. We did a Sangha day in between, didn't we? And well, first of all, your bow tie. Look at your bow tie. It's like the, one of the best things I've ever seen. The fact that you put on that bow tie for today. But honestly, it's been a total pleasure to work with you. And as you say, these events are super complex. We've been having meetings for 8 months, something like that, for this, to make this day happen. And you've just put all of this love into it. And sometimes it's been a real hassle. Like, there's been loads of sort of obstacles to overcome and complexity to manage and relationships to smooth over and favors to pull in. And you do it all with so much grace. And it's so obvious that you're kind of in love with the Dharma. And you want to make it available with your whole life. And that's what it's felt like working with you. In a way, you felt like part of our team. We felt like part of your team. It's just been absolutely fantastic. So feel free to unmute yourself if you like, just to thank Nyanadara, because without Nyanadara, this wouldn't be happening today.
Indeed.
Hundreds of people around the world coming together. And Nyanadara has been the glue that's made it all happen.
Thank you, Nyanadara. Wonderful. You put so much work into this. I know it. I really, really appreciate all that energy and love.
Thank you.
Nyanadara. Yes, been a fabulous day.
Sadhu, brother. Sadhu. Sadhu, everybody.
The Dharma Bamboo. How you doing, Amanda?
Hi, mate.
I can't see you. I can just recognize your voice.
Yeah.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much for your kind words. It has actually been a pleasure. It's been hard work, I won't lie, but it's been a real pleasure. And there's been so many people who've contributed. I mean, I didn't mention the London Buddhist Center team have been absolutely brilliant in every respect. So accommodating. We've been staying in their communities and they've just been absolutely brilliant. So a lot of people have put a lot into this. So I'm very, very grateful. So what we're going to do, I suppose in a way what we're going to do now is do what we traditionally do at this point. We start with the dedication and we end with dedication as well. And what we're doing is we're dedicating the merits. So basically this is a traditional thing, isn't it, in the Dharma to say, well, whatever benefit I've gained from being involved in this and doing this thing, may it be for everybody. And I think that spirit is right from the beginning has animated our Buddhist movement to enable people, more people, to meet the Dharma and practice the Dharma and come together as a spiritual community with the Buddha as an ideal of awakening. So what we're going to do now is we're going to do this in English and Spanish. So we'll have it in Spanish first. And who's going to do the responding? Bodhi Kamala is going to do the responding in Toluca, and then we'll do it in English with Sangadara responding, and then we'll finish. So this is the last bit of Triratna Day, and thank you so much for being with us today. It's been a real pleasure, and I hope you've enjoyed it at home and got something from it, a deeper understanding of what we are and what we're doing. Okay, so we'll just sit for a moment in silence. And then we'll do the transference of merits in Spanish, and then in English.
Transferencia de méritos. Que el mérito alcanzado por mis actos.
El mérito alcanzado por mis actos.
Sirva de alivio a todos los seres que sufren.
Sirva de alivio a todos los seres que sufren.
Mi personalidad a través de mis existencias.
Mi personalidad a través de mis existencias.
Mis posesiones.
Mis posesiones.
Y mis méritos en las tres vías.
Y mis méritos en las tres vías.
Renuncio yo a ellos sin reserva alguna.
Renuncio yo a ellos sin reserva alguna.
Por el beneficio de todos los seres.
Por el beneficio de todos los seres.
Así como la tierra y otros elementos.
Así como la tierra y otros elementos.
Se hacen útiles de mil y una formas.
Se hacen útiles de mil y una formas.
Al infinito número de seres.
Al infinito número de seres.
Que habitan el espacio ilimitado.
Que habitan el espacio ilimitado.
Que así de igual modo.
Que así de igual modo.
Yo me transforme en algo que mantenga.
Yo me transforme en algo que mantenga.
A todos los seres situados a través del espacio.
A todos los seres situados a través del espacio.
Hasta que todos ellos.
Hasta que todos ellos.
Hayan alcanzado paz.
Hayan alcanzado paz.
Transference of merit and self-surrender. May the merit gained.
May the merit gained.
In my acting thus.
In my acting thus,
go to the alleviation of the suffering of all beings.
Go to the alleviation of the suffering of all beings.
My personality throughout my existences.
My personality throughout my existences.
My possessions.
My possessions.
And my merit in all three ways.
And my merit in all three ways.
I give up without regard to myself.
I give up without regard to myself.
For the benefit of all beings.
For the benefit of all beings.
Just as the earth and other elements.
Just as the earth and other elements.
Are serviceable in many ways.
Are serviceable in many ways.
To the infinite number of beings.
To the infinite number of beings.
Inhabiting limitless space.
Inhabiting limitless space.
So may I become.
So may I become.
That which maintains all beings.
That which maintains all beings.
Situated throughout space.
Situated throughout space.
So long as all have not attained.
So long as all have not attained.
To peace.
To peace.
And with those words, our celebration of Triratna Day comes to an end. So, yeah, thanks so much again for coming. And you might like to unmute yourself and say farewell.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye. Lots of love from Mexico.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Lots of love from Manchester. Well done, everybody. Fantastic day.
Good night.